like a tree planted by the water, we never will run dry.
Of the Lord and to the Lord for his glory.
Amen and amen. Well, good morning. Sure is good to see all of you here today. It's always a blessing to be here and worship with you, and I'm so glad you're here. If you're a guest this morning, I'd like to invite you, if you would, to look in the pew rack in front of you, and you're going to find a card that says welcome across the top. Would you take that? Take about 30, 45 seconds. Fill that out, and in a moment we're going to worship the Lord with our tithes and offerings. And when the plate comes by, slip that into the plate this morning and let that be your gift to us this morning. What we'd like to do is take that information that you give us and use it to help you connect here at St. Andrew Baptist Church. We'd love to be able to help you find a place where you can plug in and serve the Lord. I don't know about you this week, but I needed to be here this morning. I love to gather with you and to worship. And you say, well, what is worship? And I'm going to tell you, worship to me is just coming and remembering all that the Lord is and all that the Lord has done for us. And to remember that even in those tough times, as we learned in our Life Change group this morning, that when the testing comes, that it's normally to help us to learn better how to reflect His glory. So we want to worship Him for the next 60, 70 minutes. So right after I pray, we're going to begin the next part of our worship by celebrating baptism. Just a glorious picture of someone saying, hey, I am on the Lord's team now. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this time to gather together. Lord, you know, how I've needed this. So would you help me, I pray, just to put everything behind me, not to worry about last week and not to be concerned about the week to come, but help me, I pray, Father, just to know you. Father, as that song said, would you just fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire to know you and to make you known. Father, I pray that in the next few minutes, would you help us just to focus in on you this morning, to hear the words of the song, to sing those songs to you, Lord, to worship you. And Father, when Brother Mike comes to proclaim the word, would you just help us to hear the message that you have for us today? I pray all these things in your mighty name. Amen.
Baptism does not save us. We are saved when we put our trust, our faith in Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior. But baptism is one of the early ways that we have an opportunity to obey the Lord by giving testimony of our faith. In baptism, a person is saying to those that witness that baptism, I believe that Jesus died, He was buried, He rose again. When I invited Him into my heart, I died to the old life of sin. I'm buried with Jesus in baptism. I rise to live a new cleansed life in Christ. This is Elizabeth Griffin. Elizabeth, have you indeed invited Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior? In obedience to the command of our Lord and Master, because you have made a public profession of your faith in Him, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with our Lord in baptism, raised to walk in newness of life. It's okay. This is Emily Hawkinson. Emily, on our student retreat just a couple of weekends ago, prayed and invited Christ to come into her life to be her personal Lord and Savior. So we've not presented her to you yet, but she comes making known her faith in Christ, desiring to follow the Lord in baptism, and after that to be a member of our church family. So if you receive her as a candidate for membership in our church after her baptism, then you'd say, amen.
Amen.
Amen. And Emily, have you indeed invited Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior? In obedience to Christ's command, because you too have made a public profession of your faith in Him, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with our Lord in baptism, raised to walk in newness of life.
Thank you.
breath in our lungs, we pour out our praise to you.
In Christ alone, our hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, burn through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand.
Praise the Lord in the power of Christ.
As our men come forward to receive this morning's tithes and offerings, children, let me remind you that you will be dismissed to Kids on Live after we pray. Pray with me. God, we acknowledge that you are King of Kings, that you are Lord of Lords, that you are sovereign over all. And we worship you. We give you glory. We give you praise. Father, we acknowledge that you have done great works in the body of Christ here at St. Andrew Baptist Church. Lord, and we pray that you continue to lead us, you continue to guide us as we move forward with ministry right here in our city and all around the world, as we've seen through this little Global Impact Celebration video. We look forward to what you have in store for us. God, I pray that we would be found faithful to be obedient to what it is that you're calling us to do. Lord, and we know that part of that is giving. So Lord, we come to you seeking to be obedient, seeking to worship you, seeking to honor you by giving back. Lord, I pray that with these tithes and offerings, that we will follow your leadership, God, and that they would just be multiplied, and we would continue to hear testimony after testimony of how it's used to bring glory to your name. But God, we thank you that you work through us, and we pray that you would continue to do so. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Come behold the wondrous mystery in the dawning of the key. He, the theme of heaven's praises, robed in frail humanity. In our longing, in our darkness, now the light of life has come. Look to Christ who condescended, took on flesh to ransom us. Come behold the wondrous mystery. Power. Christ in power resurrected, as he will be when he comes.
Thank you. What a wonderful time of worship. Folks, the book of James is a book that strikes out at pretense. And honestly, that's why there's many of you that love this book. Many people have told me, even when I just began to preach it, oh, that's one of my favorite books of the Bible. And you love it because you're wanting your faith and your walk with Christ to be real, to be genuine. And that's what the book of James is all about. It's about a faith that works, that works in us, that works through us, that works around us as God is working in our lives. It's a faith that's real and not pretend. It's a faith, as James has described it to us in the first chapter, it's a faith that endures when trials come. It's not double-minded. It's not based, nor does it seek the riches of the world. It's a faith that has victory over temptation. It's a faith that leads us to a place of gratitude to God, where we are grateful for every good thing in our life, recognizing that it's come not by the work of our hands or the productivity of our mind, but as a gift from God, the source of every blessing. It's a faith that wants to be a part of God's harvest. First of all, by being a part of the harvest ourselves, by coming to faith in Christ, but not being content to stop there. Not being content to just be part of the harvest of God that will live with the Lord forever, but wanting to then turn into be one of the reapers of the harvest, to help gather in others as they come to faith in the Lord Jesus. It's a faith that harnesses anger so that our anger does not undermine God's message in us and through us. It's a faith that is willing to repent when wickedness, when filthiness enters in our lives and we stumble in sin, to be willing to go back and repent and to fill ourselves with the Word of God. It's a faith that brings us to the Word of God and makes us committed students, that makes us want to not just read casually or occasionally, but to dig down into the Word, not just for the accumulation of knowledge or information, but for the doing of the Word, for the living of the Word. Now, as we come to the close of chapter 1, the Holy Spirit through James puts an exclamation point on verse 22 that we studied last week. But be doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves by speaking these words. And this is our message today, on the pure practice of the faith. A critical instruction on the pure practice of our faith in verses 26 to 27. Stand with me. Let's give our complete attention to these words from God. If anyone among you thinks that he is religious and does not bridle his tongue, but deceives his own heart, This one's religion is useless. Pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this: to visit orphans and widows in their trouble, and to keep oneself unspotted from the world. You may be seated. Now I wonder if you find it interesting, as I did, that in a passage that is about abandoning pretense, it's about the pure practice of our faith, that we find both the word religious and religion in just two verses. And the surprise might be greater still if you were to take the time to look to find out that any form of the word religion or religious, do you know that those words are only used 5 times in the whole Bible? I mean, we just don't see that word very often. And the word religion, quite honestly, gets a bad rap from us born-again Christians, especially from us Baptists. Because we are often telling people, I mean, I've said these words many times myself, you need relationship, not religion. Ever heard that? I'm not going to make you confess you said it. Okay, ever heard that? All right. You need relationship, not religion. You know, and the thought in that sentence is true. Because we're saying that all of us need a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, and not just a list of rules or the repetition of liturgy. We're saying, you know, what you need is to know Jesus personally, because He is alive. We're saying you need to trust the risen, living Savior, Jesus, as Lord, as Master. And in trusting Him, there is life. Life eternal and life abundant. And we often express that thought with the simple summary: you need relationship, not religion. But while we may think of religion as just kind of the mindless repetition of liturgy, we think of religion as just going through the motions of spiritual practices without authenticity or reality. We think of it as keeping rules with the thought that keeping those rules brings us salvation or somehow makes us righteous. Well, I want you to understand that's not really what the word religion means. And it's certainly not what James is talking about. When he's talking about being religious, when he talks about pure and undefiled religion, he's certainly not talking about just mindlessly doing things of a spiritual nature or just keeping a bunch of rules. I'm sure most of you remember back when I was teaching through the book of John, and don't turn to your neighbor and say, "Did he teach through John?" You'll discourage me. I'm sure most of you remember when I was teaching through it, I actually came to a verse there that offered us the opportunity to see a definition of what religion really is. And you put that down in your notes. And I could just ask those of you that weren't here then to lean over to your neighbor and say, "Tell me what he said." But I'm not going to put them on the spot. I'm going to just repeat it for you. Religion is the systematized worship and service of God. It's the systematized worship and service of God. Now let me just give you an illustration. If this big building, this church, were not here, but there were just a group of us believers who met together at the corner of 98 and Beck, we said, "Let's meet together Sunday morning around 10:30. Let's just worship God." And so we just met out on the vacant field that was here, and we We sang some songs of praise, and some offered testimony of what the Lord had done in their life, and someone read the scripture, and we all participated in that, and then someone preached the word of God, and we sang and prayed and worshiped some more. And when we were finished, we said, you know, we need to serve the Lord too. Someone said, you know, let's all bring some food tomorrow morning, and let's set up some tables across the street, and somebody comes by and they need some food, let's share some food with them, and we'll tell them about the Lord, and we'll share the gospel with them. And so Monday morning we did that. And when we were through, we said, let's meet again next week for worship. And we came back the next week at 10:30, and we met, and we sang, and we prayed, and we read scripture, and we preached the word, and we worshiped God together, and we said, let's serve the Lord again tomorrow by the giving out of food. And so we met over there, and we did it again, and so we said, this is a good idea, let's do this again. And so we did it again and again for 6 weeks, and we did it for 6 months, and we did it for 6 years. Folks, somewhere in between the very first few times that we met for worship and that we went out and served the Lord in this way, and that 6-year anniversary, somewhere between there, what we were doing became religion. Now, that's not bad, but it became a practice with us. It became a systematized kind of thing where we said, this is a good way for us to worship and serve the Lord. And we started doing it repeatedly over and over again. And it became our regular practice. And that's what the word religion means. It means the way that we regularly worship and serve the Lord. So what James is talking about is how do we regularly worship and serve the Lord without losing the authenticity? How can we do something over and over again, even for years, and it still be real? And it still be genuine, at least as genuine as when we started, and maybe even more so? And he says, That's what the pure practice of faith is like. And here in these couple of verses, James gives us just a core sample of what it means to practice our faith with purity. And he gives us three qualities of genuine, undefiled religion. First of all, he says, it is a tongue that is bridled. You know what a bridle is. You know, the bridle has that bit that you put in the horse's mouth so you can control him, so you can steer him. And James says, when you are practicing your faith in purity, when it's genuine, when it's authentic, then you have a tongue that is bridled. Folks, let me say, the reason that James probably mentions this first is because this is often the quickest way that other people, especially lost people, but also other Christians, will make an evaluation as to whether the faith that you espouse with your lips, whether that faith is genuine and authentic or not, by what happens with your tongue. Whether or not we can control our tongue, whether our tongue is bridled, whether we hold it back, whether we hinder our tongue from speaking wicked words or venomous outbursts, or vindictive comments, or hurtful exclamations that are filled with hatred. Because, folks, if our desire to practice our faith, if our desire to make our walk with the Lord and to worship and honor God, for that to be genuine and sincere, if it's not strong enough to exercise control over our tongue, how strong is it? If our faith is not pure enough to control what we say, how pure is it? If people hear these things coming out of a mouth with an unbridled tongue, they wonder, is it pretense? Now, I'm not going right now to add more on to this. About this quality of the pure practice of faith, not because there is not plenty more that we could explore, but because there is so much more to consider about this, that James, a little later on in his letter, a little later on in his book, is going to write nearly an entire chapter about this. So I'm going to wait till we get to that part of James. And then we'll see what the Spirit of God has to say through him to us about our tongues. But meanwhile, let this serve as a warning to us all. If you are a person and you really do want to be serious about your faith, I mean, you want the practice of your faith to be authentic, you want it to be genuine, you want it to be real. You may know that there are times you mess up and it's not, but that is the genuine desire of your heart. It's really what you want. Then be warned. Be attentive to what comes out when something makes you mad. About how many people get wounded from the sword that is in your mouth. If WikiLeaks had a tape of everything you said in private, would you be scared to death? Because everybody would know. Now, if those questions are convicting, then before we get to that chapter in James, you might want to spend some time in repenting, in recommitting, in working on your anger and on the bridling of your tongue before we get to the detail of what the Spirit of God says through James on this. The second thing that I want to mention that James says is a part of our pure practice of the faith is refusing to tolerate the filthy stains of the world. Now, actually, in our text, this was James' third point, not his second one. But I'm taking it second because we've already considered his primary point here. He's actually just coming back and reminding us of some key things. You know, this isn't all he has to say about this, but he's saying, I want to pause here to say, if you really want the practice of your faith, what you do repeatedly to worship God and to serve God, you want this to be real. You want to be genuine. You want to be authentic. You don't want to be pretending. Then you need to remember that one of the things a person like that does is he bridles his tongue. Another thing that he does is he will not tolerate filthy stains of the world in his own life. James 1:21 told us that if there were filthy, wicked stains in our lives, we needed to do two things. One, repent. Number two, implant the Word of God in our lives and obey it. We need to turn away from it, abandon it, and then bring God's Word and plant it in our lives, not just to know it, but to do it. Continuing sin in our lives keeps us from a fully authentic practice of our faith. Filthiness stains us. Wickedness hurts us and it hurts others who are around us. Now, God, of course, already knows. He knows every moment whether the practice of our faith is pure and genuine or whether it is pretense. But folks, when our lives are spotted or stained with sin, when the filth of the world is on us, everybody can see whether we are living a genuine expression of our faith or not. The third thing I want to mention, and this is James' first mention of this marker. It's the first time that he's mentioned this quality. That he says, if you have a life that's authentic, you have a life that's genuine, if the practice of your worship and of your service to the Lord really comes down to the core and it's the pure practice of your faith, he says, pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this: to visit orphans and widows in their trouble. Folks, the principle here is very simple and it's exceedingly clear. A real follower of Jesus Christ will care most about those for whom Jesus cared. Now that makes pretty good sense, doesn't it? I mean, if I'm following Jesus, really, I'm going to want to do what Jesus did. I'm going to care about what Jesus cared about. Is that true? That's what James is saying. And who did Jesus care about? Well, in a nutshell, the disadvantaged, the hurting, the oppressed, widows, and children. And folks, especially, Jesus cared about widows and children. Folks, do you remember that God instructed the first church? Now, I'm talking about First Baptist Church of Jerusalem, all right? When God started the first church, he instructed the church to create a special group of officers within the church who were to have the primary job of taking care of the widows. And he called them deacons, which means servants. He said, you're to have a special group of men in the church that are servants of God, and their number one primary task is to take care of the widows. We still try to obey that instruction here at St. Andrew Baptist Church. And we have a group of men. It hasn't been but just a few weeks. You had an opportunity to nominate men that you observe in the congregation that you believe meet the scriptural qualifications of being that servant in the church, to nominate some new man to be a part of that group. And that's in process right now. But we have a group of men in our church that are deacons, and their most important task is their ministry of caring for the widows. They see themselves not as rulers of the church. They have no ruling authority. They are not administrators of the church. They are servants of the church, and their number one job is to take care of widows. But our text also emphasizes children, because, folks, Jesus loved the children. Jesus still loves the little children of the world. one of Jesus' most stern warnings was in their behalf. In Mark 9:42, it says, these are the words of Jesus, "But whoever causes one of these little ones to stumble, it would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were thrown into the sea." It says, you make one of these little children stumble, you'd be better to have a great big rock lashed onto your neck and thrown into the sea than to do that. I'll tell you what. The population of the United States of America, many of it, much of it, and many of the leaders and rulers here in the United States of America ought to be trembling at their knees this moment for what they are doing to little children, unborn and born. But they're not here. At least most of them. They're not here. This is a word for us. This is a word for us that if our faith, the practice of our faith, is going to be genuine and authentic and pure and undefiled, we too must have a great compassion for the children. Now, our church has a marvelous children's ministry that reaches not only to our children, but outside of our church family to other children. But folks, there's a whole host of children right here in our own country and in the world to whom no one is ministering and for whom few, if anyone, is caring. Do you know, in the United States, right now, I mean this minute, there are over 100,000 children that are in the foster care system that are eligible and wanting to be adopted. I mean, they can be. Legally, they can be adopted. They want to be adopted. They are just waiting for a home, for people who want to be their parents to bring them into their home and adopt them and make them part of their family. Now, here in the States, if this year ends about like the last couple of years, about half of those 100,000 will be adopted into homes. But while that 50,000 is adopted, there'll be another 50,000 or more that entered the foster care system, and we will still end up, having adopted 50,000, we'll still end up with another 100,000 waiting to be adopted. In fact, almost every year, more than 20,000 of those will age out of eligibility. They can't be adopted anymore. They get too old. And so they age out of the system, never having found a home that wants them, or parents who'll care for them, people who'll try and raise them and help them. Now, as sad as that statistic is, folks, you realize that more families in the United States adopt children than any other place in the world. Yeah. We're not doing that well, but we're doing better than any place else in the world. The reason I tell you that is to say, all right, so you see how many children there are that are already in our foster care system that could be adopted, that want to be adopted, but they're not being adopted. Now, you take that number and you multiply it many, 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 many times, and that's what's happening in the world. So it's bad here in the United States, but it's far, far worse when you consider all the children of the world, every one of them. Jesus loves the little children. All the children of the world. Now, folks, because one of the hallmarks of pure and undefiled religion, one of the markers of the pure practice of our faith is the care of orphans in their time of trouble. God is raising up more and more Christian families who are adopting orphan children, making them to become their own sons and daughters. God has begun to do that in our church. I want you to meet one of those families. They're the Johnsons. Watch this.
Hello, we are the Johnson family. My name is Ben Johnson. This is my wife, Katie, Reese, Riley Kate, and Riggs.
Our adoption journey began more as a little tiny spark in our hearts before we were even married. We did not know what that would look like for us in the future. I remember being drawn to a little Asian girl who I did not even know. At that time, I wondered what God might do with that little spark in my life. After several years of marriage and two biological children, God began to unfold what He would do in our family through adoption. We began to pray about growing our family in this way. Slowly, God brought us to a place where we were ready to move forward. We had no idea what direction to go. We were open to adopting any gender and any race. We definitely wanted God to lead us in this. Ben would often say that he wanted God to make the decisions for us instead of us doing the deciding. We began to first look domestically. It made sense to adopt children that were all around us. We continued to pray about the direction that God wanted us to pursue. We ran into several roadblocks with adopting in the U.S. There is such a great need to adopt here in the States. We soon realized that God just had other plans for us. The next hurdle that we came to was deciding what country to adopt from. Again, we didn't want to get in the way of God's plan. We just simply wanted to join Him at the work that He was already doing. Through a series of events and continued prayer, God led us to adopt from China. This is when the paperwork began. God led us to a Christian adoption agency that had a true passion for orphan care. They walked us through the process every step of the way. After several months, we were given a picture and a video of our son, who was on the other side of the world. This is where the waiting process became extremely difficult. The picture of our son also gave us a little face to begin praying for. We had a little boy that truly needed us to meet his physical and emotional and spiritual needs, yet we were not able to meet them. Many of those needs remained unmet in his little life until he joined our family. Several long months later, we were on our way to China. We decided to take our other two children with us as well. This proved to be such a blessing to our family. We were gone for 3 weeks. The trip was great. We experienced many new things and even got to see friends while we were there too.
It was a whirlwind while we were in China, yet surprisingly organized. We were given an itinerary of where we were supposed to be and when we were supposed to be there, a translator, which was very helpful since we did not speak Chinese. We also met 5 or 6 other families that were going through the same adventures that we were going through. We remain in contact with them to this day. When we first met Wei Chung Shi, Riggs, we were overwhelmed. He was much more than we could have ever imagined. It was a day full of emotions. It was a relief to finally put a name with a picture and then to put a picture with a face and the actual person. He was almost 2.5 years old. The next 2 weeks with him in China were memories that will last a lifetime. China itself was an incredible experience. The people were everywhere. They were incredible. They were outgoing, but unfortunately, most of them were lost. When trying to decide whether to adopt domestically or internationally, we had talked to Katie's old youth pastor when she was in youth. He said, "Something to think about that most children in the U.S. will at least someday have the opportunity to hear the gospel, whether it's just through media or a church on every corner or people they meet, but people in China, most of them, will never have that opportunity. That was just affirmation that we were supposed to adopt from China. Since we have been back in the U.S. with Riggs, he has definitely had an impact on our family. Most folks will say things like, "What you're doing is so good. You are giving him such a good home." When in reality, I think he has made a greater impact on us sometimes. I'm not saying that there have not been bumps in the road, but there have been bumps in the road with our two daughters also. We know that God has led us down this road, and he will help us through those times. I know that not everyone is able to adopt. We felt that way also. But I can tell you that it has been much easier than we could have ever imagined, and our family has been more blessed than we could have ever imagined also. If it is something that anyone has questions about, we would love to talk to you and try to answer any questions that you may have. In the book of John, chapter 4, verses 18, it says, "I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you."
Amen. And if some of y'all want to talk to them and you don't know them, y'all wave your hands over here. They're way over, wave them high so they can find you, all right? Y'all kind of hang a minute in case some want to come find you after worship to talk to you. You know, I'll tell you that this matter of adoption is a matter that's very dear to my heart and to the heart of my wife, Karen. Most of you know our oldest son, Jeremy, is adopted. He'll have to speak for himself as to whether that's been a blessing for him, but he's certainly been a blessing to us and still is. My younger son and his wife, while they have four children by natural birth, are right now in the process of adopting a little girl from China. But folks, adoption's not the only way that we can care for orphans in their time of need. Foster care is another. The need for foster care right here in Bay County is enormous. Now, I was absolutely flabbergasted to learn that there are more children in Bay County in need of foster homes than any other county in Florida. I couldn't believe that. In fact, I had to hear that multiple times from other sources. There are more children in need of foster care homes in Bay County than any other county in Florida. They send our children in need of foster care to other counties where there are foster homes because we don't have enough foster homes to care for these children right here in our county. And another thing that God is doing is he is raising up Christian families to step in and minister to these children as well. I want you to listen to the Gilliams testimony.
So it must have been college when God started bringing this verse up into my life and heart. James 1:27. I remember thinking someday we would foster. Over the years, God continued to reveal the same word to me. Jeremy and I would talk about it, but we were never in the right stage of life to foster. We were just newly married or having our own babies, or getting kids taxied to school and sports. Time was small and finances were smaller. It was never the right time.
And it was never going to be the right time. We were always going to be too busy to serve God in this way. We would never be quite financially ready. So when Jenny brought this verse up again about a year and a half ago, God had already been working on my heart in this area, and I knew the answer was yes. I think she was pretty surprised when I pushed forward, and neither one of us was really ready. But we dove into the classes and began to get our house foster ready. We prayed, and we talked, and we prayed some more, and God confirmed this was our path several times over, as only he can. We grew closer as a couple and a family, and we got ready for our newest family member.
And then we got a call at 12:30 in the middle of the night. They had a baby, 16 months old, that needed an immediate placement. They could be at our house within the hour. Oh, and he was just coming in a diaper and an empty sippy cup.
So nothing will test your marriage like putting together a crib at 1 a.m. Most of you know this baby now. We're surrounded by friends that have brought us dinners, diapers, car seat. God was definitely providing for us, but this was only the beginning. This obedience thing is hard. Our lives have changed overnight. We've got a toddler now, and along with that came no sleep because of constant ear infections. Our time was small, communication was difficult, emotions were running high. We're constantly aware of how this is affecting our own children as well. With not as much attention from us, shorter tempers, they're now having to share rooms, and they didn't have to do that before, but through this process, they've all been amazing.
Somehow, this ministry always sounds so magical until you're in the middle of it. This wasn't magical. It was hard.
But somehow, we're always able to see God more clearly in the hard. This is where He wants us. In our obedience, in the hard, we see our need for God. He draws close to us. We struggled into a new normal, kind of, and then we got a call about another little boy. He was 5, and he needed a place to stay for a couple of days. That was July 7th, and we still have him today. And so chaos ensued all over again. But again, with intentional time with the Lord and with intentional time with each other, our family found a new normal.
And we love these two. They're such an amazing part of our family. And there's such a need, such a great need. Just recently, I asked for our local foster statistics. There are currently 72 foster homes in Circuit 14, which includes Bay County, Calhoun, Holmes, Washington, Jackson, and Gulf counties. There are currently 334 children in foster homes, group homes, or relative care. The need is overwhelming, but these children are innocent, and our God is great.
Thank you all for being a part of our journey with these little guys.
Amen.
And the Gillums are right up here in the balcony. Y'all wave so everybody can find you up there that wants to track you down and speak a word to you. Look, I'm almost through. I'm not adding a point. Bring it to prayer right now. So just hang me. With me for a second. Folks, we all know what devastatingly difficult times we live in. We know that, right? Don't have to preach that sermon again. We're aware of it. What God wants to do in these times is to use men and women who have an authentic faith. Yeah, they worship and serve God regularly. It's part of their practice. It's what they do. But they don't do it just because it's tradition. They do it because they really want to worship. Because they really love the Lord. Because they really do want to serve God. And their faith and their walk and their religion is genuine, authentic. It's what James is talking about, pure and undefiled. Now, for those of us that want that, it's not a matter of just arriving there and we stay on that plateau. It's a daily challenge to keep our faith real, to keep it authentic. So we all sometime have to work on bridling the tongue. We all have to work sometime at some of the spots and stains of the world that have gotten in our lives. We have to come back to a place we were before and repent. Renew the Word of God in our life and obey it and be cleansed. And we all need to grow in our compassion for the desperate, hurting people of our world. That includes our widows and our children especially. That we might look for all the ways that God wants to work through us to minister His grace and love to them. Stand with me.